my narwhal story, for example, that was 7 years of going back every year before I figured that out. My spirit bear was 3 good days of shooting in 2 seasons. You know, it's just putting in that amount of time to succeed.
How do you go about preparing for a shoot?
Wow, I do a lot of research. It depends on if I know the subject intimately. If it's a story, my first story I did for National Geographic was on Atlantic salmon. It took me 6 months of doing research. I had 600 contacts in 7 different countries before I even took a picture, before I even got sent on the assignment. So it's just a ton of research. And then you have to get all your equipment, and you've got to get your rebreathers and your dive gear and your backup diving gear and your soft no line, which is a rebreathing supply. You've got to pack your camera equipment. You've got to figure out where you're going to stay and how you're going to get that there, how much excess baggage is going to cost. And you just fly there with all your stuff on location, and you always put yourself in position in a staging area where you can work from there and go off and do your shoots.
And what's the process in which you'll research?
Just pick up the phone. I mean, things have changed now with Google. I mean, when I started, we didn't have Google, you know, so back in the early 2000s, you know, in late 90s, early 2000s, the internet was just kind of getting there, and Yahoo was terrible, and nowadays with the tools we have today, but it's just picking up the phone and, hey, Joe, and, well, Joe, you should talk to Jane, and Jane, you should talk to Bob, and, you know, you just keep getting sent down the path, and eventually you meet somebody. And my ultimate goal in an assignment is, by the time you arrive on location, you should have done so much research that you sketch those the exact images that are burning in your right side of your brain. Before I even go off an assignment, I have a sketchbook of images that I'm going to make that are going to allow me to tell my story for that issue.
And those images are what?
I call them, let's do a baseball analogy. I have every story needs to have one, two, or three home runs, where it's just so powerful that someone's flipping through a magazine, it's just like bang. It is so powerful that you lure them into the story. You need to have a few of those. Then you've got your storytelling images, your point pictures, pictures that help expand that story. And then you love to end off that story with another home run or another couple of home runs. And you know, so I call them your first base, and your two base hits are still important in a story to help win the game. But you need the home runs to really grab people.
And how much is that what you call pre-visualization?
Tons. I mean, I pre-visualize everything I do. Before I come up this coast where we're working on bears right now, I have pre-visualized where I want to be in the river. I know exactly what image I want to make. I know what lens I'm going to need to make that. I know where I want the light in the sky. And we say the difference between an amateur and a professional photographer is amateurs take pictures, professionals make pictures. You know, I only take 5 to 10 really good pictures a year, and if they're going to be amazing, then I need to pre-visualize the light, the tide, the current, the mood, the feeling that image is going to have. And in order to do that, so I have to know where the moon's going to be. I need to know where the sun's going to be at that time of day. I need to know, is it going to be high or low tide? I need to know, do I want the bear at the top of the tide or at the bottom of the tide, you know, of the tide zone. So you visualize all these things, and then you go through the process of waiting and waiting and waiting for that moment to come together. But that's the difference.
How much patience do you need?
Endless. I mean, patience shouldn't even be, when people say, wow, you have patience, it's like, yeah, of course, you have to have patience. You need passion, and the passion for telling a great story, for having a conservation win, is what fuels the patience. Because by the time when I visualize an image that I'm going to make, then it's going to come down. Sure, I'd love it to happen on the first day, but it almost never does. It may happen on the first week, which would be great. But quite often, it doesn't happen the whole first season, where you sit there, say, in the fall for a 2-month stretch. It doesn't happen, but I just gained and learned and gathered more intel that's going to allow me to succeed the next year. So my narwhal story, for example, that was 7 years of going back every year before I figured that out. For 2 good hours of shooting in 7 years on narwhals. My spirit bear was 3 good days of shooting in 2 seasons. You know, it's just putting in that amount of time to succeed. And I'm very proud that I've never failed a story at National Geographic. Out of the 22 assignments I've done, I've been close. I've been really close. But I just persevere and push through and just dream of succeeding.
What's the longest you've gone without sleep?
I've gone for 2.5 days without food and sleep, just on the narwhal shoot, where it just did not want to. We were in the zone. It was happening. Things were happening, and we had to get it now. And we just worked through for over about 55 hours straight.
How do you last that long and be conscious, coherent?
when you've been chasing something for 8 years and it's in front of you and it's happening, you know, you don't need anybody. You know, it's the opposite of a government job where you watch the clock and you go in and then you do your eight hours and you go home. I mean, it's just like you are so fueled up on adrenaline at this point because it's all happening. And you're so high on life because you are witnessing things that you've only dreamed of witnessing. You've been failing. I've been now failing for 8 years and all of a sudden I'm succeeding. Sleep doesn't factor into the equation at that point. Getting the shot, getting the story, and getting these images is what matters, and that's it. So,
how do you think you've grown as a photographer?
I think I've matured greatly as a photographer. I don't panic anymore. I've gotten rid of all the little voices that come into my mind of, you're not good enough, you're gonna fail at this assignment, you're out of your league, they're not gonna like your work, they're gonna see through you, they're gonna see that you're a fraud, you're never gonna get the pictures, the narwhals aren't gonna show up, the polar bears are gonna run away when they see you, all those, the neuroses that feeds into your mind. So when I mentor young photographers now, it's very much helping them deal with their little voices, that we all have them, where they try and beat you down, all those negative voices. And it's just, now I go into an assignment going, I'm gonna crush this, you know, I'm gonna go do the best body of work ever done on this species and this habitat, and the readers are gonna love it. We're gonna educate people, we're gonna have conservation wins, and we're gonna make change.